But as you can see, we're into a start sequence in the 49er FX medal race here in Genoa in Italy. We're counting down. We're into the two-minute window, and they're waiting on the line to finally get this race underway. How is that start line looking?
So at the moment, we've got this light breeze out there. You can see all positioned quite high up on the line because they don't need the distance to the line to be able to accelerate towards it. They can stay up quite close. Has a little bit of a bias towards the committee boat end, which is why we see that slight cluster of boats just positioning just off that back hip of it. Then there's a little bit of a gap, and the rest of the fleet sitting more in that midsection of the start. That means there's a little bit of uncertainty on which side of the race course they want to be going. You can see the breeze is light. There are the shifts out on there, so they're going to have to play this fairly sensibly, but certainly they're all favouring that far end of the start line by the committee boat.
Yeah, definitely. I agree with that, but it's going to be very tricky anyway, because about 10 minutes ago, the wind was at 260 and now it's down to 200. So it's really, really going back and forth and very hard to predict which side it's going to go. So, but yeah, I totally agree with you. At the moment, it's a starboard end favorite, and that's why everybody is bunked up towards the committee boat.
Now, the Italians just hiding behind that start flag are the team to catch. Carlotta Omari and Matilda Di Stefano on 33 points going into this race. Their nearest challengers from Denmark are 4 points behind. The top five can potentially, certainly mathematically, can all win gold, and who knows what might happen in these difficult conditions. So the boats to look out for are Italy, Denmark, Netherlands 6, Spain 23. As we get the FX medal race underway here in Genoa. They're across the line, and the Swedish boat leads on this left-hand side of the course.
Yeah, and the wind further shifted towards the left side, so actually 10 to 15 seconds before the start, actually it was more the port end side, so the pin end, that was more favorite, and that's why now the Swedish teams and the Italian are in a good position.
So a clear start for everyone. Julia Gross and Hanna Klinger of Sweden, closest to the camera, lead the fleet away up the left side of the course, followed closely by their compatriots Clara Wester and Rebecca Netzler. And the Italians at the moment also choosing this side. Only three boats seem to have peeled off at the moment for that right-hand side of the course, including our world champions, the Brazilians, on that far side.
Yeah, we just saw attack from the Italians. They didn't have the best start. I think they were a little bit late, and they found themselves in dirty air, so that's why they're teching out at the moment. But the majority is looking for that left side, and I think it's the ones that have a little bit of a bad start that are looking for some pressure on the right.
It's definitely all about speed and keeping this boat momentum going. So again, the more maneuvers you do, the more tacks, your boat handling's got to be really crisp, really smooth to minimize any loss within that maneuver. So again, you can see both sailors poised just right up in front of that mast, keeping their weight forward, keeping the stern out to the back of the water, keeping that look at those little ripples running out the back of the boat. They're just trying to minimize that. We can certainly see the Swedish team looking really comfortable on this left-hand side. They've got a good bit of space. They've also got that room below them to bear down, be able to access that little bit of speed. But at some point, they're going to have to look to come back across this fleet and put themselves back in the midsection of this fleet. But at the moment, they're in a pretty controlling position with that group there.
Yeah, but just as we speak, actually the wind is shifting towards the right-hand side, so it's actually the group of Rubble and Van Aanholt, the ones that actually tacked right after the start, that are in a favored position now. But I think we have to give it a little bit more time to see how it's going to play out, because it's very light, very patchy, and the wind is not very stable, in my opinion.
Now, looking at the SAP sailing analytics and all the wind data we're getting from the wind bots on the water, the route that they're saying, sort of where that breeze is more stable, a little bit more pressure, but also with shift range is on that right-hand side, so is supporting everything Eve's just said there. But you can see this group now starting just to break out a little bit. The final tacks, first few tacks going in on that right-hand side. So this will be the interesting section as they come back. They're pretty close up onto that ley line.
we're on board with Bad Nielsen and Olsen of Denmark, sitting second overall. And if you're watching this for the first time, I should just explain the medal colours on the left-hand side graphic, telling you how they change through the race. So currently Denmark's slipping from second to bronze right now, with the Dutch moving up into a silver medal position. But there's still lots of sailing to go, so let's not worry too much about medal positions right now, as Robel and Shea of the United States lead the fleet, according to our data and our trackers coming off the water.
Yeah, and it looks like there's just a little bit more pressure also out on the right. The wind is 20 degrees more to the right than at the starting time. And we can see from the analytics that the boats on the right side are going a little bit faster also, which explains why that group is now in the lead.
Our overall leaders, the team to catch, Omari and Di Stefano of Italy. They come from Trieste, as do a number of the sailors in the Italian team. And they're used to these light, fickle conditions. And they're certainly taking advantage of that experience. But can they hold on to that leading position as we move up this first leg of the medal race? We're about halfway up the leg now. And the Swedes tack away.
And it's going to be quite hard for the group on the left side because the wind is still in that right-hand quarter. And it's going to be interesting to see how it's going to play out, because they're quite far apart and that crossing moment is going to be crucial. But I think that the right-hand side is going to pay off, looking at the analytics and looking at the water. It's just a little bit less pressure here at the top left.
Yeah, and the angle that these boats coming back from port, lower than it was before.
Yes.
When they came out of those tacks, quite a little while before they get that boat back up to speed and that momentum here. It's going to be a tight cross here for the Dutch and the Swedish pair. See that little nudge up to windward, just trying to squeeze round the front of the Dutch pair there. But certainly that right-hand side, as Evie's just said, is that breeze. It is there a little bit more, and they've tapped into that sort of breeze quite early on. They all sailed out towards that right-hand side confidently. They're coming back across, so four boats approaching in from that right-hand side as this left-hand group try and force their way back in on this headed tack.
Beckering and Duet of the Netherlands making their way back towards the center of the course. But their compatriots are over the other side and are approaching that top mark. And they look like they are in the lead. Yes, Van Aanholt and Jongens of the Netherlands are out in front as they come to that top mark, ahead of Robel and Shea of the United States. Then in come the Swedes, Gross and Klinger, in third. So, Evie, you were completely right. The right-hand side of the course paid off. And the Dutch building up a nice lead. They came in pretty close to that mark, being chased closely by Robel and Shea, but they're building a lead going downwind. The Brazilians around, the second Swedish boat of Wester and Netzler around that top mark. Here comes the second Dutch team of Beckering and Duet. And there we just caught a glimpse of the overall leaders coming round well down the fleet.
It was interesting picking up on that left-hand side. We saw Gross and Klinger, they came round up in third position. So even though they were out towards that left-hand side, it was unfavoured side, they had good speed. They were the ones that broke away from that group. They sailed a slightly lower angle, give them the speed, took that tack across. And so still very much in this race with that, even though that right-hand side was that definite favoured side. But again, very interesting, they've split away and going back down the side that they sailed up when the favoured side is the opposite side of the course.
So the overnight leaders from Italy, Omari and Di Stefano, sitting in seventh place, over 100 metres behind the leaders, and that means that their gold medal has slipped to silver as things stand. So they really need to start working their way up the course. They need to start using all that light wind experience that they have to try and reel in the rest of the fleet. And see how comfortable Van Aanholt and Jongens are looking at the moment, but you just can't relax in these conditions, can you?
No, the pressure is always on until you cross the finish line, but I think at the mark they just went for the jibe set, and they were pretty sure about that. They saw that the right side was paying off in the first leg. However, I had the feeling that at the end, like coming towards the top mark, that left-hand side was getting a lot of breeze, but they're looking like they're very confident in their decision, and that's why they are in the front at the moment. But it's very tricky conditions, and especially on these downwinds, a lot can happen in a very, very short period of time.
Again, in the uncertainty, you stick with the golden rules. And if one side's been favoured, you tend to go back down that favoured side again and support that, which is exactly what a bulk of the fleet are doing. Just a couple of boats. See Gross and Klinger sailed that little bit further out. And again, looking at the results there, we see them sliding back. Again, when they come down towards that gate mark, it could squeeze all back up again. But it's definitely this right-hand side of the course as we see the boats returning back down that side, all protecting that area. So
can the Americans close in on the leading Dutch pair? The Americans appearing in their third consecutive medal race in the Hempel World Cup Series. They managed 10th in Enoshima, 9th in Miami, but they're doing well here. They're in a podium position for this race. So there's the bottom gate. They can choose which way to go around it. Which way would you go?
Oh, well, I cannot really see the rest of the course, but I'm pretty sure that they're going to go for the top one of the screen at the moment. But I can hear a lot of noise, so I think that something's up. Maybe there's a change in course.
Yeah, we're...
Let's look at that. No.
We hear noise off the course from the course microphones that help us, give us a bit of guidance as to what the committee boat are thinking. There's the mini map in the bottom left corner, giving us a great overview of how things stand and where the rest of the fleet are. But certainly those leading two boats are away. And think of those grey lines on the mini-map as a wind ladder. And the higher up the ladder, the better placed the boat is. The Brazilians are round in third. They started the day 7th overall. They're still out of the hunt for medals. The Brazilian pair, the Olympic champions, can only manage a bronze, but they're going to need to really pull something out of the hat to achieve that. Second Dutch pairing around and through the gate. Both Swedish boats as well. Here comes Etchegoyen.
Yeah, and we can hear the sound from the motorboat. It's indicating that there is a course change. They changed the mark to the right because the wind from the moment that we started shifted towards the right, and they're setting up a new course now.
The top mark.
The top
They're
mark,
moving
exactly.
The top mark. The mark that these boats are heading to.
Yes.
Now, have they moved that already, or are they in the process of moving it? Because how do these women manage to work out, you know, the course that they want to take right now?
Well, when they change the mark, the new mark will have a different color, and they will remove the original mark as soon as possible. So that's how they will know.
So still close between first and second. But Grail and Kunze trying to stay in touch with those leaders. As the fleet begins to spread out across the course, our overall leaders, the Italians, are now dropping back. And at the moment, they're fighting to hold on to silver.
Yeah, and the wind is also turning a little bit more towards the left side. You can see here that the Brazilian team of Graal and Kunze are sailing a little bit of a higher angle.
So the Italians dropped right back down through the fleet. And as a 23-year-old, you know, helming in her first regatta, what's she thinking? How does she come back from this?
Well, by just focusing on the conditions and focusing on themselves, I feel they didn't have a great start, and they were a little bit, catching up on everybody else in the first beat, and then not making the best decisions on that downwind. But I think that they have really good boat speed, and they have still a chance to come back. But it's going to be quite hard in these conditions.
Again, those lead boats protecting that right-hand side, taking that windward gate that we saw it, and just keeping himself towards that right hand side. But Grail and Kunze taking that left hand gate, they managed to access some of that breeze on that left hand side, that little bit of a left shift, and it's brought them in snapping distance of Roble and Shea just in front of them there. So there are those little gains to be had. It's not just about protecting this right side, but it was a solid position for the Dutch and the US teams to sit on that right side. And again, we can see in the mini map the front two boats highlighted.
A real battle going on for the Italians as they try and claw their way back up the fleet. They started the morning in a gold medal position. But at the moment, the positions for silver and bronze are changing all the time, with the Danes, Bad Nielsen and Olsen in the mix, Roble and Scheer also able to win a medal. So it's really happening down at the back of the fleet. It's all about positions, not necessarily about winning this race anymore for those crews. It's about trying to just close the gap and catch whichever boat is in front of you. But there's also an interesting internal battle within the Dutch team, isn't there? And Van Aanholt and Jongens will be very pleased with this result, not just because potentially if things stay as they are, they're going to take the gold medal. But there's a battle for an Olympic place.
Yeah, exactly. So this event is the first of two events that are counting for the Olympic qualification, and it's between Van Aanholt and Beckering Duet. They are both getting points because they are both in the top 10, and as it stands now, Van Aanholt and Jongens are going to win this event if nothing goes wrong, and they're going to take a full 10 point. And so Beckering and Duet are going to do everything they can also in this race to climb up as much as possible in the leaderboard, also to get some more points, and then it will be decided in Weymouth during the European. So for them, this is a really, really important event.
Just watching Roble and Shea just have to work over that wake from a power boat that's gone past. It certainly shook every little bit of breeze out. They came off the wire just to be able to balance and allow that rig to flex a little bit more, bend those knees, try and just smooth their way through it, and now build up that speed. But that'll be traveling, that wake will travel up the course, and say they're all going to be impacted by that. But it's that was a hard thing to sail through and battle through.
Well, Roble and Shea's chances of a medal pretty much depends on what happens behind them now. Yes, they could potentially move up a place and catch the leaders and win this race, but it's more about what's happening behind them between the Danes and the Italians and where they sit in the fleet. So really, the Americans have to just focus on their race, just concentrate on staying in front of everyone else and trying, obviously, to close the gap on the Dutch. But in many ways, they can't worry about what's happening behind them. It's out of their control. They just have to try and be as efficient as possible.
Yeah, definitely. It's something that we often say, it's control your controllables, and that's really something that you cannot control how your competition is doing. So they're just, you know, trying to sail the best they can and not lose any more places, and then they're just going to see how it's going to roll out.
Watching the race leaders, Van Aanholt and Jongens, who wear the red bibs of the overnight third place team. But they have pulled a blinder here in Genoa, and at the moment are not just dominating the race, but dominating the leaderboard. Roble and Shea of the USA, former Laser Radial Sailors. They've made the switch to the FX about 2.5 years ago. And all that practice and all that competing over the last couple of years is coming true now with their third successive medal race in the World Cup Series.
Okay, so you can see how all of the teams are now closing in on that finish line, but a battle, as we see with Grossenklinger, the Dutch team alongside, but the Italians far out on that opposite side.
But here are the Dutch, Van Aanholt and Jongens, making their way across the finish line. They have won the medal race, but they don't know what medal they've got yet. At the moment, they're holding on to silver, and it depends what happens behind them, I think. Roble and Shea of the USA cross the line in second place. Will that be good enough to seal a medal? Grael and Kunze of Brazil. The only medal they had a hope of getting was bronze at the start of the day. As things stand, they are out of the medals. Here comes Gross and Klinger of Sweden, and then the other Dutch pairing coming in as well. There are our race winners. A new livery for the Dutch team on their sails, a bright orange tulip. But has Van Aanholt and Jongens' week here flowered into a gold medal, or will they have to settle for silver? Let's see how the other boats cross the finish line, because this is crucial at the moment. Omari and Di Stefano, here they are. We're on board with them as they approach that finish line. At the moment, they've moved up into 10th place. Sorry, 5th place. And that should be enough to get them the silver as the Dutch cross the line. Here come the Spanish. And I think the Italians are crossing the finish line at the top of the screen there. So they finished in 7th place. Now, is that enough for silver? Is it enough for gold? I think the gold has gone to Van Aanholt and Jongens. Their win in the medal race, and Omari Di Stefano's 7th place finish sees them slip to silver. And Roble and Shea of the USA, who took 2nd in the medal race, may have just done enough to take the bronze medal overall. We're doing the calculations as we watch them cross the line, so they're not the official results yet. We will confirm that in a few minutes' time. But a fantastic clinical race from Van Aanholt and Jongens.
Yeah, definitely. I think they were very confident the way they sailed this race, just going out towards that right-hand side in the first beat, and then they were pretty much in control from the first mark, and then just, you know, defended their position, kept their head cool, and they sailed a really, really good event, a really good race today, and I think the well-deserved winners of the 49er FX.
So, let's confirm the results then. The gold medal has gone to the Dutch. Van Aanholt and Jongens win the medal race and win the event overall for the Netherlands. Omari and Di Stefano will have to settle for silver after finishing seventh in the medal race. And that second place finish for Robel and Shea of the USA gets them the bronze. The Danes, Bad Nielsen and Olsen, in the end finished way back in ninth place, and that saw them slip out of the podium places. The best placed Spanish team was Echegoyen and Barthelo, who finished sixth, and hopefully we'll be able to confirm with a graphic at some point the official results. But Grail and Kunze finishing third in the medal race in the end was a sixth place overall finish. Right, so there we are. Official results for that medal race and confirmation of where the medals have gone. Beckering and Duet of the Netherlands, who started in 10th, finished 9th overall in the end, swapping places effectively with the second Spanish team competing.